Hello everyone and welcome to Settlements and Survival. We are back. We are going to be doing a couple of little small builds today. All right, we're here at Oberlin. That's her little shack. Since Oberlin is one of my, it's not a depot, it's actually a feeder settlement with actual settlers and crops. I just have very, very little here. Today we're going to be building off of that little hut to build a little like a sidecar, armor, workbench, workstation, like shop, I guess. I don't know. What I wanted to show y'all in this one is how my quote builds grow, how they are like sort of organic and why they look as, you know, weird as they do. It's because when I come to a place, I only build, well, in this one in particular, since this is a secondary location for me, since I don't spend a lot of time at these places, I spend time at the depots. I don't really do a lot with these until I need to do something. In this case, I had just done the Weston Water Treatment Plant for Grey Garden, and one of the super mutants, one of the Mire Lurks, had dropped a piece of armor, a legendary piece of armor that I wanted to upgrade. So in most normal cases, you know, you come back to the nearest settlement that's networked, you know, you got all your stuff in the workbench, you drop an armor workbench, you do the thing, and then you store it or you leave it there and you just go. What I like to do in those cases is as I need things, I will stop and spend, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 minutes building a structure for the thing I'm using. Now that's not a, you know, hard and fast rule, but what happens is over time, as I come back and visit this settlement, which I rarely do, and I do things around it and I need something, I will build that thing and just that thing. Like, you know, the next thing for these people will probably be maybe a shack for the farmers. There's, you know, the two settlers that were here, I left them here. And the two provisioners I'm using are the ones I sent from Sanctuary way back in the day. So this is how, like, the organic part of it goes. Because, I mean, if I find that if I sit and just build and build and build and build, it comes out looking too samey. It looks too planned, I guess. Because it is. I mean, it's one session. There's no outside influences. There's something in the back of my head saying, okay, I've seen these types of structures lately, let me duplicate what I've just seen. Because, you know, when you're going out and you're adventuring and you're doing stuff in the Commonwealth, what you'll find is that as you go to different places, since you build, right, since we're all builders here, you subconsciously kind of examine the stuff that's in the game. You know, you kind of look at it and go, oh yeah, that's kind of a cool thing, or oh, that's neat, or I like how this whole thing came out. So as you're exposed to these things, even though you've seen them a million times, right, it's in the back of your head. And so when you come to build something, it's like you subconsciously have that like template in mind. So when you build, it comes out just a little bit differently than it would if all you were seeing as you were building was the stuff you'd already built. That sounds really kind of hippy dippy, but I found that by doing it that way, by doing it in little chunks, by doing it in stages, by doing it piecemeal, you know, not all at once, it tends to look more junky, more haphazard, because it is, you know, it literally is 12 different types of buildings. Now here, I mean, you know, I'm going to put the workbench there back in that metal shell. I mean, you've seen some of these techniques before, because I do tend to reach for the same sorts of layouts and stuff like that. But as you can see here, she's got a very, very small house. I mean, it's basically, you know, one of the deep walls, a couple of other things, you know, group selected in, the sort of roof dropped on the top, a turret sitting on top of it. She's got a bed and a chest and a water pump and the cooking station. And that, you know, in survival, that's pretty much all you need. But as it goes, as this thing grows, I got a feeling that Oberlin's going to grow maybe over those bushes there, maybe down the hill. It might barnacle up this. I don't know. It'll depend on what I need the next time I'm here. You know, and the, you know, the state of mind I'm in, what I've been seeing lately, and yada, yada, yada. So, but again, mixing materials, right? I got metal here. I got the warehouse pillar. I've got the barn chunk there holding up the ceiling. I've got the junk wall. So, okay, four different elements, good. We put the basics down here. We'll give them a tool chest. We'll put a shelf in here, put some lights in here, and a locker I'll sink into the wall. I don't know, I'm undecided on that wall, on that locker thing. I mean, it seemed like a good idea at the time, but the more I think about it, the more I look at it, it didn't really do much for me. But yeah, this is how it goes. I mean, this is more theory than the actual building, because there's not really very much here. But yeah, that's it. You know, we're sitting here and we're like 5 minutes in. So this is like 10 minutes of building here. And, you know, in 10 minutes, you could put up a small shack. So 10 minutes here and then 10 minutes the next time and 10 minutes the next time. I just have to resist the temptation to sit there and build and build and build and build and build, because if I do, that's when things start going sideways. Start looking too samey, too, you know, whatever. But like this thing here, you know, from a, I guess, a lore, quote, lore standpoint, it's like she comes back and she's like, hey, settlers, I need a thing. Let's build you guys. Let's all get together and, you know, do the Amish thing and raise a barn here. Well, it's not really a barn. It's more like a shack. But this is the type of thing you would think three people could build in a couple of hours. You know, it's not terribly complicated, but it is self-sufficient, self-contained. It's something that you could see the settlers using when she wasn't here, you know. And it's that type of stuff that I like to make it seem more, I don't know, scrappy, junky, crap shacks. And what I'm trying to do is find alternate ways to use things that I, because I mean, I'm a creature of habit like everybody else. I will reach for wood. I mean, I live and die on that wood tab. And I got to figure out a way to do, but it's like I try to go other places, you know, in the barn and the warehouse. I mean, they're pretty much the same. They're just different colors, you know. Warehouse has got the glass stuff in it, which is nice, but it's kind of specialized, you know. It's not terribly universal. And I got to figure out a way to use those things more group selecty, more thing. But anyway, okay, so here it is. There you go. There's your armor workbench ready for decoration. It's open to the air, and it suffices. And that's the whole thing there. Two little crap shacks there. So, I don't know. What am I doing here? I got to put some light in here. I don't have any light in here. I'm thinking lantern. Yeah, and then we'll put a candle up here too. Because this place, as you can see, does not have power. It's only got, what, 6 turrets? It's got extra beds because of the provisioners. You know, 2 provisioners, 2 settlers. And they've all got sleeping bags up at the top of the train station tower thing. But they'll get better digs later. And is that it? Yeah. All right. So now we move over to Hangman's Alley. You are going to see a full tour of Hangman's Alley in the next video, because I'm going to do a recap and a tour, because Hangman's Alley, I finished it after I did this, because this was the last piece I had to do. This is going to be a trading outpost, you know, a trading outpost shelter thing, you know. I find that, I mean, the first one you ever saw me build, I think, the first one you ever saw was at Red Rocket way back in the day, in the Mega Build days. And I've been using variations on this theme ever since. Now, what I want to do is I want to sink this into the walls over there, the buildings over there, but where that blue accent was. And I don't quite know if this is going to work. See, that extra wing on the right, I don't think that's going to fit. See, because it doesn't, the rocks stick up too much on the right, and it's not working. There's that angled brick thing back there. So I sink it and look at it, I'm like, aha, okay, let me get rid of that side thing. Let's just scrap it. I got so much wood now. And since I went back and stripped Sanctuary, and she's been playing and scavenging and, you know, doing other stuff. So I'm thinking, okay, how do I want to do this? What kind of profile do I want? Because the trading outpost, the caravan post, is obviously going to go in that center prefab section. And I use prefabs for that rather than a floor and a back wall and a roof for a couple of reasons. The biggest reason, of course, is because the prefabs have pillars. They have supports on the corners, and I like the way that looks. But I think there's something weird about when you use a set piece like that, like the geometry is different on it. And what happens is if I do the drop, right, I put the caravan post on a rug, and then I stick it in there and I drop it. Sometimes if there's a floor, wall, roof combination, it drops really far, like 6 feet. I mean, like halfway down, it goes way down. It's like it ignores the bottom floor because it's a separate piece. I could not begin to tell you. But with the prefab, it always hits that bottom floor. No matter where that bottom floor is, that's as far as it will sink. And I don't know. So that's maybe a tip you can use if you're trying to duplicate this sort of thing, dropping things inside prefabs. They are more predictable. I mean, they're still not completely predictable, but they're a little more consistent than the floor, wall, roof combination. So now I need an awning. I wish there were more metal roofs, man. It's just a flat one and a bulgy one, and that's it. It's like, eh. So I'm on the metal tab, put another metal thing in here. Do I really want to do that? No, I don't like the center pieces on those. The center blue, the center girder. That's why I use those round ones so much. But as always, I'm going to punt and put a wood thing down here. Put a wall? No, the wall. See, the wall sticks up over the ground. That looks dumb. So let's try one of the deep walls. Give them a little extra room there. Yeah, that'll work. Still sticking up a little bit. So now I'm going to pull it out and replace the whole thing and sink it, I think. So yeah, what we're doing now is this character now is like level 60-something, 63 now, I think. I've been playing her today, and she's going to be going to finally go talk to the Warwicks and do the Atom Cats thing. I finally did Quincy. Quincy wasn't too bad. It was a little bit easier than I thought it was going to be. I don't know why I'm putting a floor here. Oh, that's right, because I want to put one of those little things out here. But by doing that, yeah, see, I still need to put the thing back on there. And I'm like, no, you can't do that, because if you do, you'll pick up, you know, we want to go to pick it up, right? I pick up the entire thing. I pick up, like, the wall and all the stuff. It's like, yeah, that ain't going to work. That's just not going to work. So, yeah, the experimentation is always checking. When I'm doing the last thing, I always have to double check, triple check, that I'm not picking up, like, more than I want to be picking up. So I sink this a little bit lower. Try sink a little bit lower. See, there's that thing with the hangman. It's like there's a second surface, like a foot and a half, 2 feet below there, that you just can't go below. It's like, ugh. So I'm trying to figure out, okay, how low do I want this to go, and will this look okay on the floor? Okay, look, it does go on the street. So I'm not going to bother doing the floor thing. I'm just going to stick this group selects on the outside like I should have done in the first place. So, yeah. That's what's going on there. And now we're gonna do the thing. Now the secret to the trading, the caravan post, is the hop spot is in the very middle of it. It's not on the brick side. It's not on the bathtub side. It's like in the middle of the open area. So but that's too high. So I'm just gonna do this and then just drop it on there and watch for the hop. See the hop? There it is. Look at that. It's in the middle. That's so strange. But it's nice because it makes it easier to place, because you can get closer to the edge of it and when you put it in there. Do it there, have the cinder block sticking out just a little bit, drop it, and there it is. So now they need chairs and they need decorations. I mean furniture. I don't decorate this until the last. Because this is one of her depots, right? This Hangman, Starlight, and Jamaica are probably going to be the three builds you're going to see the most, that are the most likely to see from this. I mean, Hangman's for sure, duh, because it's coming next. And I do have some more tips. Yeah, see, I forgot that you can't sink the stupid thing, so the hell with it. Yeah, it won't go in there either. So, well, scrap it, hell with it. I got plenty of oil. And then, what are we going to do? Oh, yeah, more chairs, more seating. I always put enough seating for four people, because there's three of them, right? But if you put four seats down, they'll move around more. It makes it look more active. And the odds are better if you put two seats past the outside, you know, past the bathtub. Because sometimes what happens is when I make these little enclosures, I'm like, oh, sweet. But then, like, Doc or Lucas will sit in that chair in the very far back, and the stupid Brahmin will put his fat ass right in the middle of the whole thing, and I literally can't get to him to talk to him. So if I put more seats outside the tub, I get a better odds that the vendor will be where I can actually talk to him and go, hey, dude, let me sell you some stuff. But yeah, I put this here because for one reason only, to dump the crap that I keep to sell. Like when I go out adventuring, when I go out looting and scooting and whatever, I tend to grab everything in sight, right? When I do that, I come with a lot of crap that I don't really use or want. In her case, it's most chems. It's prepackaged food. I don't really use prepackaged food except for decoration. And even then, I don't like doing it. So that kind of stuff, 38 rounds, mods that I take off armor that I don't use. What else does she sell? That's pretty much all that goes in there. What I like to do is I like to put a chest or a box or a crate or a storage container really close to these outposts, right? So when the vendor's here, I just go to the box, take everything out of it, stagger three steps, sell them to him as much as I can to him, and then just go ahead and put the rest back for the next time. So that gives you a sort of steady flow of cabs. Speaking of steady flow of cabs, I have yet to set up a single shop in this game. I mean, not once. I have not got a single shop anywhere. And that's probably because all of my settlers are doing nothing but farming. If they're not provisioners, they're farming razor grain. Abernathy's all razor grain. Starlight's all razor, not Starlight. Gray Garden's all razor grain. I mean, I took all their crap and I made them all razor grain. Oberlin's all razor grain. Who else is there? Ten Pines. I made a depot out of Zamonja. What else? Taffington's a depot. County Crossing is currently a settlement, but it has no crops. It's only got two people there. And it gets attacked a lot. It gets attacked more than I would like. Given that there's only two people and there's no food and there's no water and nothing in it, except, you know, what the provisioners drop off on the workbench. Oh, yeah, and the slog. The slog is all razor grain. I might build on the slog in this one. I'm not quite sure how that's going to come out, but for now, they're doing okay. So there you go. I think this is pretty much it, right? Yep. So there you go, guys. There's a trading post in 20 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. And it, like I said, it fits into that little niche. If you're playing this in vanilla with no mods, without the unofficial Fallout 4 patch, this is inside the line. So settlers will come out here and sit in them. Well, they would if, you know, I had settlers here. But all I ever get is provisioners. And looks like that is going to be about it. So there's a trading post. There's one example of what it can look like. I hope this is interesting and useful. And I want to, where is it? Yep. I want to thank you all very much for watching and subscribing. And I will see you in the next one. Take care.